So, as you can see, we have a wonderful evening ahead of us. I'm mindful of the time, but I think if we have such an illustrious panel here, such a real opportunity, I think, to take what is, to many, an obscure illness. Give you a little anecdote. When I was a student, a high school student, I worked at a mental hospital in England one summer, and I worked in the chronic male unit. This was in the 1950s. In those days, which was, of course, the time when our youth suffered obsessive compulsive disorder, nobody really even understood what it was. We heard it was very rare, and certainly nobody could treat it. The only treatment in those days was what was called lobotomy, or Lupin, where the frontal lobes were severed from the other part of the brain, and the obsessive hand-washing or other obsessions, which were part of the compulsive anxiety that the individual suffered, that Dr. Schwartz will explain to us. That was the only treatment that seemed to make any major difference. And of course, it altered the person so dramatically that they became something other than what they were at the beginning. With Dr. Schwartz's leadership in the last 10 or 15 years, we've come to understand you can actually rethink the way in which you manage your life, even if you have the obsessions and the compulsions that go along with them.
You know, sometimes I get these feelings, Katie. I get these ideas, these crazy ideas about things that may not really be there.
Now, let's start with Dr. Schwartz.
Let me simply say this. In our current era, we now know that even though your brain may be genetically predisposed, as Howard Hughes' brain certainly was genetically predisposed, we know from his family history, from his parents, from his grandparents, to send you false messages that things are dirty, to be excessively concerned with perfectionistic concerns, to have things just so, to get feelings in your throat that make you feel like you need to clear your throat. Even though your brain, because of genetic wiring, is sending you these feelings, the thing that I work so hard with Marty and Leo on is, in our new era, we now know the power of mind to override those signals now allows us to change how our brain works and to change how the genome expresses itself. So we are now in the age of mindful awareness. We are in an age in which mindful awareness allows us to override the messages from our genome. And in the age of mindful awareness, we can look inside ourselves, and that was the key that Marty and Leo completely understood. What we wanted them to do was not mimic, not impersonate, not make it look like a person from obsessive compulsive disorder from the outside, but be a person with obsessive compulsive disorder. Make your brain what Howard Hughes' brain was when he was having those symptoms. And we now know from multiple brain imaging studies, several of which have been done by my very good friend Mario Beauregard at the University of Montreal, that when an actor portrays a part, the blood flow in their brain and the serotonin in their brain takes on the same characteristics as the actual patient they are portraying. Their brain, in a word, becomes the brain of the sufferer. And so I want to ask both Leo and Marty, how much did you feel the pain of Howard Hughes?
Well, first off, I want to take a moment to thank you for everything you did for me on this film. Your invaluable work that you put into this film and all the information that you supplied, Mr. Scorsese and I. You get a script, you read a character, you see there's two pages of dialogue of the man repeating the same thing over and over again. Now, the writer has his intention. He has his opinion of how that should be portrayed, but as an actor, it's the actor's job to then say, okay, what is the driving force behind somebody repeating something like that over and over again, which led me to Dr. Jeffrey Schwartz and to read his book, Brainlock, and really truly understand the idea of the sticky gear shift and how basically on one side of the brain, these primal urges that you have, the other side of their brain basically tells you, in most cases, people without OCD, that you're doing things that are illogical, that are unnecessary. But with the sticky brain shift, you're stuck in that mode, and you get an instinctual fear that something horribly wrong will happen to you. And you cannot stop repeating those same things or doing that same activity repetitively over and over again till that fear or that feeling of anguish has gone. I remember as a young kid, you know, walking back a block just to step on a crack because of that same feeling. At some point, you know, during my teenage years, I said to myself, okay, this is completely unnecessary. You're late for school. Let's stop this. I was able to make that distinction. When doing the film, to answer your question, the answer is yes. I did then say to myself, okay, let's revert back to that time. Let's start doing these things over and over again. I want to re-experience that even off the set. And it just so happened that it really kicked in full force when I let it. So in doing that, you know, I would go home, I would do these obsessive things repetitively over and over again, and sometimes, you know, they'd be waiting for me on set and take sometimes 10 minutes for me to take that walk to set. I'd have to walk back, and they'd, I'd just listen to the banter of the PA, the production assistant say, well, oh, he's coming. No, wait. Not yet. No. Need a couple minutes.
I knew it. But you finished the film on schedule. So I just want to say 91 days. Thank you. I'll get another picture to make then. But this, we had to have a chart, basically, of what manifestations could occur in this particular scene at that time in his life. And even though we shot out of continuity, you could always refer to the chart and basically play around with ideas, whether it's a coughing, a nervous cough, or the thing we noticed of whatever footage was shot of Howard Hughes, he kept sort of touching his pant leg this way and when to introduce that. And very often, because we were out of continuity, he'd say, do you think I should do the pant leg? And I said, I tell you what, it may be too soon, but since we're in that position, let's get one take and do it. Things like that, and we experimented a lot like that. Ultimately, this was weeded down and sort of chipped away at in the editing process, where we begin to notice there's too much of this, too much of that one, until ultimately it had to build to the final sequence in the screening room, where he locks himself in the screening room, to be the most extreme, we thought. Then ultimately, for me, it was the nature, the emotional perception, his emotional perception of the objects, or the infected areas. It's how he saw them. That means that it's the angle of the camera, and it's the size of the frame. And do you do it from his point of view? Do you do it from a side? It went on and on like this, and actually was part of some more enjoyable aspects of making the film. For example, and there's a scene where a gentleman has polio and is in a men's room, and he says, could you pass me a towel?
Could you reach me a towel?
And Howard Hughes, his head moves. We see Howard's point of view with the towels. That means that the camera's aiming down from his eye line, and the towels are looking up at him as if to say, dare to touch me. Now, cutting back to Howard's reaction, it's from the point of view of the towel. It's not a close-up of Howard looking this way. It's from down here.
I really can't do that.
I was really getting very, very much involved in the almost an animation or of the actual objects or the infected areas of the plate, many different scenes, particularly a scene with the doorknob. It was constantly, how do you take them? Well, it's just an insert. It says, no such thing as just an insert. The insert here, this shot tells us the whole story and how he's reacting to it. And then the angle of the thumbprint on the glass that we see later in the film and how you look down to the thumbprint. All of this was devised way before shooting began. And that was all worked in within the context of all the work we did with Dr. Schwartz throughout the entire shoot of the picture.
Just elaborate on one thing, you know, in learning about Howard Hughes, you know, he was not the genius he was if there wasn't some sort of madness. And that compulsion in him is, I think, what really attracted, especially, you know, certainly you, Marty, I know you've said that, and me especially, in portraying this character. And certainly, when you're talking about the screening room sequence, which you guys are about to see soon, we started to learn how somebody who is that caliber of a genius, somebody who is that technically brilliant, who put all this effort into airplanes and engineering, who then reverted all that energy and all that genius and all that brilliance into the minutiae of delivering his lunch. And that was some of the most riveting, powerful stuff in the research that we read. The angle in which the paper bag should be given, the way he should reach into the bag, the 35-degree angle, not to cough, not to speak while he's in his presence. I mean, there were memos and memos.
Actually, I imagine it happening to me. I mean, I've had instances in my own life and that sort of thing, and I think a lot of it was reverted to religious ritual. And then, you know, you read the Golden Bough, and you get a sense of those basic elements that the concept of magic, what is primeval in magic, what is you know, an effigy of some person, and the idea of a voodoo doll, which becomes something that seems to have been touched upon in every culture. There seems to be something in ourselves as human beings that relates to that, that it has a need for the sense of a quote magic unquote, a sense of some sort of reprieve from or a retreat from the chaos of the universe. You know,
I think we're human beings are desperate for control.
Yes. Yeah.
I think one of the interesting things about the fact that he was such a good pilot was that when you're in the pilot seat and you're making the changes that you have to make to fly that plane, you become actually one with the machine. And in a curious way, that's what Dr. Schwartz does when he helps his patients understand how they can control their brains,
the
extension
really nice.
Of the brain in Hugh's case, although he didn't realize it, was his flying and his flying machine, which apparently there was evidence that he was happiest about.
Oh, there's no question. I just want to make one fast point. We now know from Mario Beauregard's studies and from other studies that when these actors make their brain be what the sufferer's brain is, they do it exactly the way Leonardo just described. You use autobiographical memory. And what that says for all of us is that when we relive our past, we are actually getting our brain back into the state it was at that time. When we know that with mindfulness, it allows us to use the impartial spectator, the inner observer, to overcome ritual and use ritual constructively so that we're not merely ritualizing, but we're using traditions from the past to understand the state of our brain at some past time, and this frees us going forward to make wiser choices. And this brings me up to thank you so much for being here, Terry. So much. Can you just say a few words about perfectionism and Howard Hughes?
Howard, I remember, he made a movie, and he had kept it around for years and years, named Vendetta, with Faith Domergue. And every night for a year, I'd have to go, because there was no DVDs, Marty, I'd have to go to the screening room at Goldwyn and watch that movie. He was editing it. And he was such a perfectionist that he would take frame by frame where she looked good and make multiply those, and a frame where she didn't look good, he would take that out. Can you imagine anyone doing that? I mean, for hours, and I would say, you know, an old Southern expression, Howard, you're all hung up in your underwear. You're never going to get anything done. I mean, there's calls coming in from worldwide that they need him. You know, TWA things are happening. This is happening. The world is falling apart, and there you are. And as I say in my book, I loved him then, I love him now, and I shall always love him. He raised me. I was with him for my most formative years from 18 to 25. And we were very much alike. I loved aviation more than anything in the world and making motion pictures, and he did. And Marty and Leo, I just want to congratulate you because I'm your biggest critic, and I loved it. And I'm glad I'm a member of the Academy, and most of my friends are because...
Thank you, Terry.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.